Hello, and welcome to this presentation, Measuring Filters with a ZPH. In this presentation, we'll show you how to make basic measurements of radio frequency filters using a Rohde & Schwarz ZPH cable and antenna analyzer. This presentation covers the essential information needed to make basic filter measurements with a ZPH, but please see the separate presentation, Understanding Filter Measurements, if you're interested in learning more about this topic. Let's start with a brief review of filters. Filters are two-port devices that attenuate radio frequency signals as a function of their frequency. Another somewhat simplified way of saying this is that filters pass some frequencies and block other frequencies. Filters are generally grouped into four categories based on the frequency ranges that they attenuate. Low-pass filters pass lower frequencies and block higher frequencies. And high-pass filters do the opposite. They pass higher frequencies and block lower frequencies. A band-pass filter passes only signals within a certain frequency range, or band. And a notch or band stop filter is used to block a usually narrow frequency range. Filters are critical components in almost all radio frequency applications, and they may be either board-level components or external connectorized devices. There are many different instruments and techniques that can be used to design, adjust, and measure filters, and in this presentation, we'll show how this is done using the ZPH. The Rohde & Schwarz ZPH Cable and Antenna Analyzer is a portable vector network analyzer that supports both two-port transmission, or S21, measurements, and one-port reflection, or S11, measurements. Both scalar or magnitude measurements and vector or phase measurements can be made with a ZPH. Measurement results can be displayed in a variety of formats, and results can be easily saved or exported in standard formats as well. In the remainder of this presentation, we'll go step by step through how to perform both transmission and reflection measurements on connectorized filters using the ZPH. There are five basic steps in making filter transmission measurements: configuring the source or tracking generator, configuring the measurement frequency range, performing normalization, adjusting the trace type and/or resolution bandwidth, and viewing or analyzing the results. Let's start by discussing tracking generator configuration. The ZPH's tracking generator is configured by pressing the Scale Amplitude Hard key and then selecting TG Power from the menu. Note that the tracking generator power can also be viewed and edited directly from the main ZPH screen. The maximum configurable output power is 0 dBm. Care should be taken not to set the tracking generator output power level too low, since this can lead to inaccurate measurement results. On the ZPH, filter transmission measurements are made in cable and antenna mode. To enter this mode, press the mode hard key on the front of the ZPH, and then choose cable and antenna from the list of available on-screen options. Next, press the measure hard key and select transmission to perform filter transmission measurements. We also need to specify the frequency range over which the filter will be tested. This should cover both the passband as well as some portion of the stop band. To define the frequency range, press the frequency distance hard key and then enter the range either as start and stop frequencies or as center and span. The number of measurement or trace points over the span can also be specified by pressing the sweep hard key and choosing number of points. Recall that a greater number of points will provide greater detail, but this will also increase measurement time. A very important prerequisite to any transmission measurement is normalization. Normalization can remove or reduce the effects of cables and connectors on the measurements. To run normalization, press the Cal Span hard key and then normalize transmission. A through should be connected where the filter will be attached. After pressing continue, normalization will complete in just a few seconds. Here is a typical display before normalization. Although the tracking generator output is constant, the frequency response and attenuation of the cables will create an uneven or wavy trace. After normalization has been run, the line should be flat, and the level of this line should be normalized to 0 dB. All filter transmission measurements will now be relative to this level. After normalization, we're ready to make measurements. The through that was used for normalization is removed and replaced by the filter under test. By default, the ZPH will sweep and update measurement results continuously, but this can be changed to a single sweep by pressing the sweep hard key. The vertical scaling can be adjusted using the amplitude hard key. Reference level is used to define the upper limit of a trace, and range position is used to scale the trace vertically and to move the trace up and down. Note that the ZPH also has an auto scale key that can adjust these values automatically. Here is an example of a transmission measurement made on a bandpass filter. In the next few slides, we'll go through how to adjust additional parameters and how to analyze or measure the properties of a filter from a trace. There are two settings that can help when viewing results. The first is changing the trace mode from clear write, which updates the display with every sweep, to average, which displays the user-defined average of n traces. Averaging can help reduce noise on the trace, and this is particularly true when looking at the stop band. The average trace on the right has much less noise in the stop band compared to the unaveraged trace on the left. Another important setting is resolution bandwidth, which can be manually adjusted by pressing the DTF bandwidth hard key and then bandwidth. Lowering the resolution bandwidth will decrease the displayed average noise level, or DANL, but will also increase measurement time. For example, measuring with a 100 kHz resolution bandwidth gives a DANL of about minus 80 dBm, but decreasing it to 1 kHz lowers the DANL to about minus 100 dBm. One reason why trace averaging and lowering DANL is helpful is that they allow more precise measurements of the difference between the passband and stopband attenuation. This is something we'll talk about in more detail in just a few moments. Markers are enabled using the marker hard key and can be used to numerically measure filter characteristics. Up to 6 markers can be placed on a trace, and these can be either absolute markers or delta markers, which show the difference between marker values. Toggling between types is done by using marker type. The functions provided under set marker can be used to automatically place markers on the peak or minimum values of the displayed trace. Let's use markers to make some basic filter measurements. We've placed 3 markers, one on the center frequency of our filter passband, here approximately 782 MHz, and one each on the lower and upper 3 dB points, which is how filter passband is normally specified. Looking at the difference between these two 3 dB points, we can calculate the passband of our filter as being approximately 12 MHz. Next, we'll use a standard marker and delta marker to measure insertion loss and out-of-band rejection. Insertion loss is how much the filter attenuates signals within the passband. This should be as small as possible, and here our filter has an insertion loss of about 1.5 dB. On the other hand, a high out-of-band rejection is generally desirable, since this is the amount of attenuation the filter applies to signals outside the passband. Measured with a delta marker relative to the passband, the out-of-band rejection for this filter is approximately minus 99 dB. Recall that using averaging and a lower resolution bandwidth can help in making accurate measurements of the level difference between the passband and the stopband. The last basic measurement we'll look at is passband ripple, or how much amplitude variation there is within the passband. Here, we're looking at a low-pass filter with a 3 dB cutoff frequency of about 428 MHz. The highest gain within this passband is minus 0.17 dB at about 216 MHz, and the lowest gain is minus 0.91 dB at about 300 MHz. Using a delta marker between these two points, we can directly read off the passband ripple, which for this filter is approximately 0.72 dB. Next, we'll look at making reflection measurements on filters. Most filters are reflective in that they block or attenuate signals by reflecting power outside of the passband back towards the source. In cases where reflected power might be an issue, special absorptive filters can be used instead. Although we normally associate filter testing with transmission or S21 measurements, reflection or S11 measurements are often useful because they show how well a filter is matched at different frequencies, as well as whether the filter is reflective or absorptive. We make reflection measurements using the ZPH by connecting the generator output to one port of the filter and terminating the other port. Note that this is a so-called vector measurement, that is, we are measuring both magnitude and phase. The most common ways of looking at filter reflection measurements are using a return loss plot as well as the Smith chart, but note that the ZPH also supports a number of other display formats as well. The steps in making a reflection measurement are essentially the same as for transmission measurements, with one exception. Instead of performing a normalization using a through, in reflection measurements we need to perform a one-port calibration using a set of calibration standards. Let's look at this in a little bit more detail. A one-port calibration should be performed before any reflection measurement, and this process involves sequentially attaching an open, a short, and a match to the tracking generator or RF output port. These standards can be in the form of discrete standards, or may be combined into a calibration T. In addition to these manually attached standards, electronic calibration units can also be used. These switch the standards in and out automatically and are controlled by the ZPH. Regardless of which type of standards are used, the process is started by pressing the Cal Span hard key, selecting the calibration kit, and then full one port. Next, simply follow the prompts for connecting the manual standards or the automatic calibration unit to the RF output port. To start reflection measurements, press the mode hard key and cable and antenna as before. This time, however, press the measure hard key and select return loss as the measurement type. Let's look at some filter reflection measurement results. Here we're looking at a bandpass filter which has a high return loss within the passband, meaning that power outside of the passband is being returned to the source. Changing from return loss to a Smith chart display, we can confirm a high degree of impedance mismatch outside of the passband. The trace lies closer to the outer edges of the Smith chart for the stop band frequencies. Both of these plots are consistent with a reflective filter that attenuates signals by returning power outside of the passband back towards the source. Let's end with a brief summary. The Rohde & Schwarz ZPH cable and antenna analyzer can be used to measure filter characteristics, including both transmission or S21 measurements, as well as reflection or S11 measurements. Normalization or calibration are important for ensuring accurate measurement results. Measurement parameters and display modes are user adjustable, and filter characteristics such as frequency, bandwidth, attenuation, and ripple can all be easily measured using markers. And although this presentation has been focused on filter measurements, the methods and settings used for measuring filters can often also be applied to other two-port devices, such as couplers, amplifiers, etc. This concludes our presentation, Measuring Filters with a ZPH. If you'd like more information about network measurements, filters, or network analyzers from Rohde & Schwarz, please see the links in the video description. Thanks for watching.